travel the world and you will find few cities as beautiful, as breathtaking, as true to your imagination as Cape Town. Blessed with a perfect climate, spectacular vistas, and some of the most productive farmland on Earth, Cape Town, at first glance, appears to be the most salubrious place on Earth.
And it is. But dig a little deeper, look past the picture postcard images, and you'll also find a buzzing, urban, decidedly multicultural city. Let's be clear, this is a complex city. This is a contrasting city. This is Cape Town. Welcome, my friends, to the Mother City. So we're about to land at Cape Town, so it's probably a good time to talk about the airport. You know, for a long time, it was weirdly difficult to get to Cape Town from outside of Africa. But in recent years, more and more international flights have started serving the city. Our friends here at Thomas Cook recently launched their London Gatwick to Cape Town direct service. So you're no longer stuck choosing between one or two legacy carriers or enduring time-consuming connecting flights when you want to get from London to Cape Town. Frankly, why would you want to faff around with a connecting flight when you can enjoy all of this on a direct flight?
Right after we landed, I managed to ask a frequent visitor to Cape Town one of life's most important questions.
I wanted to talk to Ray because I gather you're a bit of a Cape Town fiend.
Yeah, I love Cape Town.
Why?
It's just the first time I went, just when you go there, it's just breathtaking, the scenery, everything, the people, the foods, the wine, it's amazing, everything.
If you could eat one thing while you're in Cape Town, what would it be?
Steak, 100%.
Steak,
it's the
really?
Yeah, it's the best, 100%. And you could get, like a 16-ounce steak for about £12, and obviously in the UK would be like £35,
yeah. £40. You didn't even hesitate.
I didn't hesitate, no, it's amazing.
All flights land at Cape Town International Airport. Located about 20 kilometers from the city center, it's a modern, compact airport that received a major overhaul for the 2010 World Cup. When you land, go through immigration, grab your bags, and are finally breathing in that beautiful Cape Town air, there's a few ways to set off on your adventures.
If your hotel doesn't have its own airport shuttle, the best way to get to and from the airport is Uber. UberX will cost you around 200 to 250 rand and takes about 25 minutes to most locations in the city. Be warned though, during rush hour, traffic to and from the airport is gnarly, so plan ahead. For a slightly cheaper option, try the My City Bus. A one-way ticket to the central business district will cost 88 rand in peak periods and isn't much slower than a car. The buses are clean, safe, and reliable and depart every 30 minutes.
Or you can do what Greg and I are doing and rent a car.
Nice, a Corolla.
Do we have to put up with this? Surely we can get a better car. I know we're a small show, but we can do better than this, surely.
We can get one of those.
Cape Town's public transportation system is very good, but it won't give you the freedom that having a rental car would. It allows you to explore the greater Cape region, places like Franschhoek up here, and means you can do things on your own time. Uber is definitely the most popular and frankly the windiest way of getting around the city. Uber is definitely the most popular way to get around the city and frankly the easiest. There are cars available all the time at all hours of the day, and it's a lot cheaper, or at least it feels a lot cheaper than most of the cities that we've covered in the show today. The relationship between Uber and the local taxi firms is unsettled at best, and we've heard from friends here that taxi drivers will actually try and dissuade you from taking an Uber, but we've taken both while we've been here, and I gotta recommend Uber. It was cheaper, it was faster, they arrived quicker, so your mileage may vary, literally and figuratively, but I'm gonna stick with the recommendation of Uber on this one. And finally, unless you're a fan of adventure sports and near-death experiences, do not take a minibus taxi. They are unregulated and unsafe.
If you live anywhere in Europe and you're enjoying an apple in January or a grapefruit in November, there is a damn good chance it came from the Cape. Vast plains of fertile soil, a fair and predictable climate, and a farming culture that stretches back for centuries allows Cape Town to produce some of the best produce in the world. Mix that with a cultural fascination, dare I say obsession, with food and drink, and wonderful, wonderful things happen.
Nazli and Yusuf, owners of Bokap Kombes, a Cape Malay restaurant in the district of Bokap. The term Cape Malay isn't necessarily a reference to the ancestral homelands of this community, but to the common faith shared by hundreds of thousands of people who arrived in South Africa, often against their will, in the 17th and 18th century.
So your nationality, or where your ancestors came from, didn't matter.
No.
It was based on faith, and then you were given a label based on
absolutely.
That. Absolutely. Oh, okay.
So Malays were given to the Muslim people. I have no ties with Malaysia, but we embrace those people. You see, if you come from Malaysia, they will call you a Malaysian. Mm. Not a Malay, a Malaysian. But the people here are called Cape Malays. Got nothing to do with right. The country Malaysia. But it is a term that we lovingly embrace, you know. Shakespeare said, a rose by any name still right. smells sweet, so you call me what you want. I'm still the same person.
Where there is strong community, there is always beautiful food. Cape Malay cuisine is the result of centuries of blending traditional South African staples with the spices, techniques, and flavors of maritime Southeast Asia.
Today we are serving you very traditionally Cape Malay, the babwati. And there's a good history behind that also, why babwati and how it was preserved at the time when babwati during the slave time became one of the staple meals of the people. Here we have a lamb curry with our rice and the roti. The roti is the flat breads we make and roll them and put them in the pan until it flakes, and you give it a little bit of a smack, and it comes all nice and crispy. So that's your curries. Here's your chicken curry. This is leg of lamb that we use.
Locally sourced ingredients, flavored with spices roasted right here in the restaurant, prepared by a kitchen team from all over Africa, equals one of the most satisfying meals on every level that I've ever had.
I don't think I've been this full and happy in a long, long time.
There's a food whose very name will bring a knowing smile to the face of every Cape Townian: the Gatsby. Gio Gignoni introduced us to this beautiful abomination.
The full one you can feed 2 or 3 people, quite easy.
Okay. I am excited to try this because I've heard so much about it.
See your char grilled steak Gatsby, the barbecue basting one, and also the masala one.
Cool.
So it's gonna be nice and saucy and spicy.
Fries, steak, sauce, cheese, salad. The Gatsby was originally created to feed hungry fishermen after a long day at sea.
I should carry it like a baby.
But it's now a Cape Town institution.
It's a beauty.
That is stunning. I can imagine that this would be the best. I've had a bit too much to drink food.
It's a little messy.
Yeah, I can see why you live so close to us.
The masala steak Gatsby brings a whole new level of spice to the game. And that is a beautiful thing.
You need bigger hands.
No, look at it. Oh, wow. The masala.
We've had some amazing food in pretty much every city that we've been to. But it's gonna take a lot to beat the Gatsby.
This is a very important question. What is the difference between now, just now, and now?
Over some biltong and boa wars, Cape Town tech entrepreneurs Cobus and Rich were finally able to shed some light on a nugget of Cape Town slang that has confounded me for years.
Now means this very present moment.
Okay.
We are sitting
most
at
likely
this table
this
now.
Very present
moment. Yes. So what now means to the rest of us?
Yes.
Like the normal definition of now.
Now means I'm running late. It probably means about 5 minutes.
5 minutes, and as soon as I possibly can.
Yeah.
Stay where you are, I'm on my way.
I'm in traffic, yeah. I'll be there now.
Okay. Yeah.
Just now means I haven't left yet.
Okay.
I will be there, but just now.
So that would explain why we sat in the lobby of the hotel for 45 minutes when the person said, I'll be there just now.
Yeah.
And we're like, that means we have to go downstairs right now.
That's finding you again, but based effort, right? Yeah.
You have unlocked a mystery of the universe.
Within striking distance of Cape Town is one of the most productive and unique wine regions on Earth.
Yeah, I think South African wine is arguably, I suppose, the most exciting wine region in the world at the moment. In terms of old world wine regions, you've got the established areas of France and Italy, and to a lesser extent, I suppose, California and Australia, but most guests and visitors to South Africa are going to know those wines quite well, and are looking, I suppose, in many ways for something which is comparable in terms of quality, but is unique in terms of taste and experience.
So what is it about this region of Southern Africa that is so conducive to producing grey wine?
It's really the only area of South Africa which has a truly Mediterranean climate. So warm summers, long wet winters, fairly cool winters. And then we obviously have the added benefit of the topography that we have here. So everywhere where these beautiful mountains you see around you have been forced up out of the earth, you've got differing types of soil, different aspects that the mountains provide in terms of the sun, where it is in relation to the vineyards. So we've got a really, really unique topography and terroir here in South Africa, and particularly in the Cape. And what makes it even more unique is that it's a relatively speaking quite a small area. So you only have to travel short distances to get extremely varying areas and microclimates that you can actually grow grapes in. So I think that's probably what makes us the most unique in terms of what we have to offer here.
Cape Town and South Africa have a troubled past. There's no denying it, there's no ignoring it. While its people are not defined by the choices their country made generations ago, the effects of those choices are still felt, are still seen, and are still being reconciled today. District 6. Today, what appears as a quiet inner city residential area was once ground zero for the apartheid regime in Cape Town. An almost entirely black neighborhood throughout the 19th and early 20th century, in the 1950s, the government began segregating communities based on the color of their skin.
It became a law that was called the Group Areas Act of 1950, whereby the black people were forced to live with the black people, the colored people, Muslim people. That's why today we have the existence of the townships. Like Langa, which we are going to visit. That's why today we've got existence of the colored areas and existence of the Muslim areas. It's because of that system that the government introduced in the 50s.
Godfrey, a community activist, and Loazi, a resident of Langa, explained how the sudden displacement of the inhabitants of District 6 gave birth to the townships.
The other side that we're just coming from through the road over that side, these are mostly the houses that were built first. When the people were taken from those other areas surrounding Table Mountain, they were brought up here, they lived in these houses, and of course, having lived in those houses, they then referred to themselves as Cape Townians.
The government built the houses?
They built those houses, yeah, and out of them being built, they were to, cater for them coming from that side, not necessarily to own them, because nobody before 1994 was allowed to own land as a black person. But after 1994, of course, they were granted opportunities to own, were open to buy and sell.
This situation is made even worse by the renovation of overcrowded township homes to make way for better, but much smaller housing, which in a sickening twist of irony actually displaces more people.
It's 64 different families, and here it's 15 families.
15? Wow.
So you renovate the structure, it only takes 15. So
you're not solving the overcrowding problem.
Shackled by the draconian apartheid laws, the townships developed into self-sustaining communities with their own commercial and political infrastructure. But with the demand for housing far outweighing the supply, vast neighborhoods of temporary structures built with whatever materials the community could gather sprang up around the townships.
I was born in one of these, so which will be this one, actually.
Rooms intended for two people became living spaces for entire families. But people like Godfrey, born and raised in Langa, have fought long and hard to improve the lives and opportunities for those living in the townships.
They call it the monument, yeah? I mean, the locals don't want to take it out, but it's against the law not to take it out. But the people of this community said, leave it there.
By representing and championing the township communities at a local and national government level, you get a sense that real change is happening in the townships.
Currency in South Africa is the rand, and the value of the rand in recent years has been, to put it politely, volatile. But with the recent weakness in the pound and the euro and a rally by the rand, Cape Town is still a very affordable place.
Alex.
Oh, we should do the rundown. This is a cup of coffee, and it will cost you 15 rand, which is less than one British pound. A pint of beautiful South African beer will cost you around 40 rand.
And as much as you all hate it, the most reliable indicator of a nation's cost remains the good old Big Mac, and that costs 26 rand.
Cash is easy to get a hold of. There are ATMs. You settle down. Do you mind? Cash is easy to get hold of. There are ATMs throughout the city, and they'll all take your Visa or MasterCard debit card. But a quick thing on ATMs. If someone approaches you and offers to help you with your ATM transaction or ask for your help with theirs, doff your hat and crack on. All they want to do is put their hands on your money. It's a common scam. Avoid it. This is the most beautiful country I've ever been to. I wonder what South African modern folk superstar Jeremy Luce thinks about it.
I always loved the nature and the way that I still had access to, I suppose when I was younger, I didn't realize that I had access to this really modern city. But after spending 10 years on the road and pretty much traveling to every city in the world, I've come to realize that cities are normally either like big epic cities or they're very like nature places. You know, I've been in the Caribbean where it's just beautiful islands. But then after a few weeks, days, you start to miss being able to get a coffee and some Wi-Fi and just a bit of that modernity. And similarly, when you're in beautiful, massive cities like New York, you're like overwhelmed with the pace of it all, but it doesn't take long, at least for someone like me, to start missing the mountains, the sea, warm, beautiful weather in the all year round. And I think that's why I always come back to Cape Town. It always kind of registers as not just home to me, but just one of the most awesome places ever, because we have this beautiful city surrounded by nature and beaches and mountains, and it's kind of the best of all worlds, you know. So yeah, that's why I love Cape Town.
Come to a city like Cape Town, it's easy to flick between luxury hotel, beautiful sandy beach, tourist trapping A, B, and C, without actually ever seeing any of the real Cape Town. If that's your jam, fine, but you are missing out on a city with 1,000 stories to tell. So dig a little deeper, embrace your sense of adventure, and this city will reward you like no other.
Despite a troubled past that is far from being resolved, there is a beauty in the sense of pride, the sense of community, the pure positivity that radiates from every South African. A lesser people would have buckled under the weight of its own troubled history, but South Africans aren't your average people. They're tough, they're proud, they're committed. They smile more than any other people I've ever come across. And I think that says a lot about this country, past, present, and future. Thanks again to our friends at Thomas Cook for flying us nonstop from London Gatwick to Cape Town. Check out the link in the show notes below to book your Thomas Cook flight to Cape Town.